Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. This video will be the sixth video. It's a continuation for the fifth one. In the fifth one, we talked about Palestine and the British. And this here, we'll talk about Palestine during the British Mandate and after. The Ottomans fought against Britain, and unfortunately, the Arab Revolution helped the British. Because unfortunately, Lord Lawrence of Arabia managed to get some people into his side, and we know that Sharif Hussein moved on from Mecca to the north. So all of this happened at the same time. At the end, General Allenby entered Jerusalem on December 30, 1917, and he declared martial law upon his entrance. And unfortunately, many notable people in Jerusalem, including the Mufti, welcomed him. But at that time, 1917, it was just pure British ruling. There is no British mandate on Iraq or French mandate on Syria, just British mandate on Palestine, because like we said earlier, in the negotiations and political works happened behind the scene to solve the Eastern question, preparing the Arab Revolution, and you got talking or and preparing for Balfour Declaration. Many things happened during that time, and one of them is that Palestine, as it shows in the Sykes-Picot Agreement, is assigned to have a special status. What's the special status now? The time is coming, giving it to British mandate. So Britain, after that, they tried to manage even the Muslim religious affairs. So as an example, they assigned Sheikh Amin al-Husseini to be the Grand Mufti, despite his young age and opposition from other ulama in the town. And they created the Supreme Islamic Council, Al-Majlis al-Islami al-A'la, for him. So they have him to be the Mufti, and they created a body organization for him, so that now he will be very prominent and have very great influence in Palestine. And they started immediately encouraging the Jewish migration to Palestine. And the Jewish Agency for Israel was established in 1929, operative branch of the World Zionist Organization. And acquiring the land started, mostly from Lebanese and Syrian families and few Palestinian families. And many books were written about the land transfer in Palestine. A clash at the same time started, beginning 1920, 1921, because now people start, wait a minute, what's going on? So they started clashing with the Jewish migration. Now Britain, from the day one, they have double standard. They allowed the Jews to carry arms, to defend themselves, but Palestinians were banned from that. And we know by that time, under the British Mandate, many organizations were established, many Jewish organizations were established for this purpose. In 1929, Al-Burak uprising happened, and many people were killed and even executed. We have in the history of Thulatha al-Hamra, the Red Tuesday, in which three prisoners were imprisoned in Akka, and Britain excused them. They didn't allow them, even they didn't give their bodies to the families to bury them. Later on, they were buried. They buried them at the beginning in the prison. Now, many people joined to stand against Britain. One of them is Sheikh Izzeddin al-Qassam. Sheikh Izzeddin al-Qassam is from Syria. He helped people in Syria against the Italian, Libya, against the Italian occupation. And he fought against the French occupation in Syria and then came into Palestine in 1920. He was Sheikh, he was Ma'zun in some town near Haifa. And he led the resistance against the British. He realized that, wait a minute, if you want to do the job in a good way, focus your opposition to the British, not to the Jews. because the Jews are used as a tool in this conflict. And he was killed in 1935. In 1936, general strike happened, ended after 6 months upon the promises from Arab kings like King Abdul Aziz of Arabia. And many people emerged in fighting, Abd al-Rahim Mahmoud, Hassan Salama, so many people started the opposition to this, to what's going on. And Britain managed also the political life at the same time. Would help some families in Nashashibi, Raghib al-Nashashibi, in establishing Hizb al-Difa', the defense party, after he lost elections for Jerusalem municipality. And As'ad al-Shuqayri, the father of Ahmed al-Shuqayri, joined him. So many leaders fought genuinely, but at the same time, many names started coming up who were ready to work with the British. And at the same time, some Zionist organizations, like we said before, Shamir established Stern or Lehi, Argon, Menachem Begin established the Argon, and Ben-Gurion established the Haganah. Later on, Haganah turned to be the IDF, and they banned the first earlier two organizations, and they converted to political party. So Menachem Begin established the Harut, and later on Nahal, and later on Likud, which is joined by Shamir, which is the current Netanyahu's party, which is actually following the revisionist Zionism. Many attacks during that time happened, carried out by Zionist organizations, especially the Stern and the Irgun, Shamir and the Begin. In 1938, 39, the Second War occurred, and Hitler now is coming to the power with his racist Nazi ideology, and the Holocaust happened. It pushed, of course, it increased, I would say, more migration to Palestine. Many commissions were established to discuss the conflict, but all of them failed. Some commissions were established by the League of Nations earlier, and then by the United Nations, and by British government, by US government, and all of them failed. The partition happened on 1947. As an example, Bernadotte mission failed. He presented a proposal not accepted by the Zionists, so he was assassinated by Stern in September 1948. That's why this organization and Begin's organization were labeled as terrorist organizations. In 1948, suddenly, Britain announced the end of its mandate on 15th of May of 1948. Immediately, Ben-Gurion announced the creation of Israel. Zionists already built their intelligence unit called Al-Musta'ribun, the Arabized. Nowadays, if you read you see in the news, many attacks happen in West Bank carried out by people who look like Palestinians. They speak Arabic, they dress like the Palestinians to deceive people. So that the route for that unit was established by Ben-Gurion back in 1948. Now the League of Arab States decided to send its armies, and I wish they did not. They got the first truce, and then at that time the situation was favoring Arabs, but there was a truce. So you have to accept. So they accepted it, unfortunately. During this, Israel enhanced its power. It established air force, navy, and tank battalion. Then the second truce was on July 1948, only after the balance started favoring the Zionists. Now, the role of Arab rulers was suspicious. Just to mention one point, Arab armies that entered to fight in Palestine were headed by British Colonel Globe, who later on turned to be the Jordanian Army Chief of the Staff. And after, in the 50s, I remember, if ended his service, or King Hussein fired him. So imagine a war against the British baby will be managed by British colonel. And if you read the more details we read about this, the more you keep saying, we wish that Arab countries did not enter. There were some heroism in this case, no doubt, but there are a lot of things going on behind the scene. The Nakba started, and everything else afterward was a natural consequence for this until today. Now, in the Nakba, if you go back to the map of Palestine, you see the Gaza Strip. The Gaza Strip today is 365 square kilometers. At that time, it was much more. It was around 560-something square kilometers. At that time, after the Nakba, Gaza became under the Egyptian authority. The military ruler, the Egyptian military ruler in Gaza was Mahmoud Riyad. People, and like we said, the area of Gaza was much larger than today. And people there, they kept going every night to their farms, which is now occupied by the Israelis, to take whatever they want from their farm and come back. So the Israel complained to the military officer in Gaza, and he signed an agreement with them in 1950. It is called Ittifaqiyat al-Oja, the Al-Oja Agreement. Al-Oja is a small area in the between Najaf Desert and between Sinai. In that, he gave away those 200 square kilometers to Israel and shrinked the Gaza area to the current one. This happened after the Nakba. People keep, I'll talk about this, about ethnic cleansing. Ethnic cleansing happened, and the one who actually carries this issue seriously is Ilyan Pappé in his book, The Ethnic Cleansing in Palestine. And Dr. Riaz Segal, an Israeli expert, non-Arab, non-Palestinian, non-Muslim, non-Christian, Israeli Jewish expert in modern genocide. He calls Israel's assault in Gaza a textbook case of intent to commit suicide. He says it is a shameful use of lessons of the Holocaust. The Holocaust happened, of course, no one can deny it. But now Dr. Segal says that what you are doing, this is a shameful use for the lessons of the Holocaust. He said it in Democracy Now! With Amy Goodman in October 2023, October 16, after the new military campaign started. Now, there are many massacres happened, and I cannot list all of them. So I will just talk about some of them. King David Hotel Massacre in Jerusalem, 1946. It happened again by Jewish Stern and Ergun terrorist organizations. Balad al-Sheikh in Haifa in December 1947. Deir Yassin Massacre, again carried by the same organizations in 1948. Tantura Massacre, May 1948. The Tantura Massacre was exposed just recently. No one knew about it. They just buried people and have a parking lot over their dead body. Until recently, you know, some academics and some journalists kept digging in it until they brought it up to the scene. And there is, I think, Netflix had documentary about it. And Al-Lud in 1948, Al-Dawaima in 1948, Al-Akar in 1948, Those I don't remember because I was born in 1949. Now, you have Qalqilya massacre in 1956, I remember it. Massacre of Qibya, 1953, I remember it. Kfar Qasim, October 1956, they didn't talk about it. Now, there's no social media now. Now, if a person is near cuffs in Damascus, we'll hear about it here instantly. But before, it depends on the radio of Israel, and there was no TV. So, and the radio of Israel is managed by IDF. So, later on, people started knowing about this. Now, some of them before the Nakba, and some of them after the Nakba. So, when we talk about Ad-Dawaymi in Hebron massacre, Akka massacre, Qalqilya massacre, Qibya, all of this before, after the Nakba, even Kfar Qasim. And some of them are in 1948 occupation area, like Kfar Qasim and At-Tantura and Akka. And some of them are in the West Bank. Some of them even are not in Palestine, outside Palestine, like Bahr al-Baqar primary school in Egypt in 1970, remember it. Sabra and Shatila in Lebanon, Palestinian camps in Lebanon, 1982, it happened. Qana massacre, Lebanon, 1996. You know, UN compound in Lebanon was shelled. Even if you want to consider the victims of USS Liberty, over 34 U.S. sailors happened after during the Six-Day War in 1967. It also, if you want to consider it massacre, but it was deliberate action and caused the death of 34 U.S. sailors. So, but my point here is not to list all massacres, just few. Now, what did some British Jewish, you know, people say about the homeland? We have some of those quotes. Cohen, the chairman of Jewish Board of Guardians, he said the establishment of a national home for the Jewish people in Palestine presupposes that the Jews are a nation, which I deny, and that they are homeless, which implies that in the countries where they enjoy religious liberty and full rights of citizenship, they were separate entities, unidentified within the interests of the nations which they form parts, an implication which I repudiate. This is in Palestine Papers, page 16. Mundgau, the only Jewish minister who opposed, in the British cabinet, who opposed Balfour Declaration. Imagine, Balfour Declaration was opposed only by one minister in that cabinet, and that minister was a Jew. He said, I wish to place on record my views that the policy of His Majesty government is anti-Semitic. He viewed the creation of Jewish homeland in Palestine as being anti-Semitic. I wish to place on record my views that the policy of His Majesty's government is anti-Semitic, and in result will prove a rallying ground for anti-Semitics in every country in the world. This is from the site Council for Arab-British Understanding, 100 years since Balfour. Now, Wiseman is considered also the other father of Israel, along with David Ben-Gurion. He was the president of the Zionist organization and later on the first president of Israel. Should Palestine fall within the sphere of British influence? That's in 1914, he said it. Should Palestine fall within the sphere of British influence? And should Britain encourage a Jewish settlement there, a British dependency, we could have in 20 to 30 years about 1 million Jews out there, perhaps more. They would develop the country, bring back the civilization to it, as if there was no civilization, and form, that's the point, and form a very effective guard of the Suez Canal, and perhaps be a valuable protection against the aggression from Constantinople. Palestine can easily become an Asiatic Belgium in the hands of the Jews. His letter to Scott. Scott was the Manchester Guardian, one of the editors of the Manchester Guardian at that time. Today it's the Guardian. First it was known Manchester Guardian. So he wrote, Weizmann wrote this letter to one of the editors, P.C. Scott, in 1940. And this can be the reference for this letter can be found there. So what does it tell us? Again, it tells us that not all Jews, first of all, agree on this project. Some of them even went on to say that it is anti-Semitic, like what Edwin Mundga said. He was the Secretary of State for India in the British cabinet between 1917 and 1922. But he wrote this commenting on the voting within the cabinet regarding Balfour Declaration. And some of them said it clearly that it is to help the British interest as an effective guard for the Suez Canal. That's why later on in 1956, you know, when Abd al-Nasser upon actually asked the British to leave the canal, the attack happened in 1956, carried on by Britain, France, and Israel to protect the Suez Canal. Of course, it ended up occupying Sinai, but later on, the UN resolution upon the pressure of US against Britain and against Israel withdrew from Sinai and opened the Suez Canal for everyone, and even opened the Red Sea to the Israeli navigation. So it tells us this, that this is not just a Zionist settler colony, but rather a British settler colony used Zionism and used the question of the Jewish question in Europe as a justification, as a pretext to create this entity. That's why Izzeddin Qassam focused his struggle against the British, not against the Jewish settlers in Palestine. So this is the point which we need to learn. And inshallah, I mean, we'll continue in the next video. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh.